Welcome to a new episode of the Data Discovery Channel. And today my guest is Martijn Veenvliet. Martijn, welcome.
Thanks.
Martijn is a data engineer at InfoSupport, a colleague of mine. And Martijn, today we are going to talk about the Power Platform. I remember, I think it was 2010 that Microsoft introduced Power Pivot as an add-in in Excel. And then came Power View, if I remember correctly, and Power Query. And then, of course, came Power BI. I think most of the viewers of the Data Discovery Channel will know Power BI. But these days we have the Power Platform. So that suggests there's a lot more than all those tools that I mentioned. And you dived into that Power Platform. So can you take us along? What's in the Power Platform?
The Power Platform. That's the low-code platform of Microsoft. And in this platform, there are multiple tools which you can use for creating business applications. So you can create a simple web app. You can create a mobile app and tablet app. And with those apps, you can help your business to simplify some processes.
And by low code, you mean that there's no coding required, or at least not real code, let's call it in that way. No C# programs or .NET programs or Java, but it's way simpler, isn't it?
Yeah, it's way simpler. It's like the basics. You can create an app without programming. If you want to extend a little bit, you can program a little, but it's not necessary.
Yeah. Is it comparable to low-code platforms like Mendix, which is very popular?
Yes. One of the tools within, that's called Power Apps, that's comparable to Mendix and OutSystems.
Okay. Well, great.
Yeah.
Okay.
So if we look in the Power Platform, and the Power Platform is, if you look at the Microsoft environment, you can see, and you put all the tools on a line to IT knowledge. You have on the bottom line, you have IT, you have Office products, because if you use Office products like Word and Excel, you do not really need the IT knowledge.
You just use it.
Yes, you just use it. On the top side, you have programming languages like C, C#, F#, the .NET framework, etc. And for those program languages, you need a lot of knowledge about programming.
Yeah, you need to be an IT pro.
Yes, you need to be an IT pro. And right there in the middle, you have the business applications, like the whole Dynamics suite. Mm-hmm. So finance and operations, for example, Business Central. And next to that, you have the Power Platform. So the Power Platform is like, you do not really need IT knowledge. But it will help you a little.
Yeah, and you need IT knowledge to make it all work. Just like buying CRM is not enough. You have to configure it and make sure that it runs correctly.
Yes, yeah. Correct. So you do not have to be an IT pro, but you have to have some knowledge about IT.
Yeah, clear.
If we then look at the whole Power Platform, there are multiple tools in it. And the biggest tools are Power Apps, Power Automate, and Power BI for a lot of people. For a lot of viewers, I think it's Power BI is one of the most known tools.
Yeah.
But it's also Power Apps and Power Automate are in it.
Mm-hmm.
And below we have Common Data Model and the Common Data Service. And the Common Data Model is like one big data model where all the entities of the whole world is mapped by Microsoft, and that's an open source project. And the Common Data Service is like a database which is using the Common Data Model. And the database, the data source, is available within the whole Power Platform. So Power Apps can write data to the Common Data Service, Power Automate can get data from it, and Power BI can get data from it.
Okay.
So it's like the glue in the whole environment.
Yeah, we can make a separate episode of the Data Discovery Channel just about that. That's pretty big.
Yes. Yeah. So that's why today we're only going to handle Power Apps and Power Automate, because a lot of users will know Power BI already.
Yeah, okay.
So let's start with Power Apps. Power Apps is a low-code tool for creating business apps. So you do not really have to program. You do not really have to make code. But you can create apps with it, like a web app, a mobile app, or on the phone. That's mobile. And there are three types of Power Apps. There's a model-driven app, which is fully focused on the most important processes, the core processes of a business. You have the Canvas app, and that's more focused on user experience and user interface. And you have the Portal app, and that's a little bit of an odd one, because that app is focused on the external users, like your customers, while okay. Model-driven app and the Canvas app are fully focused on your internal users.
So those can only be used within your own domain?
Yes.
And the Portal apps can be deployed to a public website for your customers?
Yes, correct.
Okay.
Correct. Mm-hmm. So let's go to a demo.
Yeah, we always love demos.
Yeah. So for this demo, I created a really simple company which sells books and bicycles. And in this for this company, I created three apps. I created a model-driven app, a Canvas app, and a Portal app. First, here we're going to the model-driven app. And the model-driven app has a really basic look and feel, but it's really easy to create. For example, here I have a navigation bar with some of the pages I created with orders, with items and customers.
So that's your model, basically?
Yeah, that's my model. Yeah. And here I have some views, a view with all my data. So for example, here I see that that Martin Wienvliet is an active customer.
Mm-hmm.
Here we see some items, a book and a bicycle and the price. And here we see orders.
Mm-hmm.
Now each page is also multiple views. So for this, like these are the not validated orders, the validated orders, definitive orders, and sent orders.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can filter your data, and you only see the data you want to see.
And is this already part of the app that you're developing for the user, or is this the developer experience?
This is really the no-code experience. So you can just drag and drop it. I'll show you right away. So in this stop, I am at the data part of my app. And mm-hmm. in this data part, I have multiple entities. For example, here, the sales order entity.
Mm-hmm.
This entity has multiple fields, multiple columns, you can say, and a few custom columns, like the status, the quantity, line number, and number. And I can show those columns using views. So here I have some views. And for example, like I showed you before, it was the validated orders.
Mm-hmm.
I can open a validated orders view. And here you see a basic table with some columns over here, the data in here. And here are available columns that I can use. And I can just drop one of those columns in the table and edit.
Yeah, so you're just creating a simple view on top of the data that you have.
Yes, correct. And here mm-hmm. on the right side, I have a sort by option and a filter by option. And right now, if I can just, if I'm happy, I can save it. I can here publish it. And then it will be able, it will be available in the app, in the model-driven app.
Mm-hmm.
It's published. And then it will just come here when I'm using the validated orders. It will add the column over here.
Okay. Yeah.
It didn't edit yet because there is some caching and there's some time to publish it.
Okay, I understand. Yeah. Okay, so very, very simple.
Yes. Next to it, we can open an order, and we have here a form where we can change the order. So we can change the item, for example, or change the date of shipment. We can change the quality. So here we have a form, an edit form. And you also can use the same form for creating a new order here.
Mm-hmm.
And these forms are also editable within the entity. So here we have the forms top, and here you can create an own form or edit a different form. And while the view tab was the view, creating a view was really static, you can only just drop a few columns in it. The form view is a little bit more flexible.
Free form.
Because you have on the right side here, you have some events and you can upload some JavaScript libraries to do something fun, something cool.
Okay, then it's not really low code anymore if you have to use JavaScript, but.
Yeah, so you can use it like no code, because like this form, I didn't write any code for it.
No, you're right. I haven't seen any code yet, so.
Yeah, I didn't write any code. But if you want something more fancy, you can use to add some JavaScript. So next to that, you have a few components you can use, multiple input types. Mm-hmm. And with those types, you can really easily create your form. And that's the model-driven app, basically. There are also a few other things like charts and dashboards. But those aren't not really working well yet. So we have, for example, here a dashboard with over a chart with all the quantity sold over dates.
Would you expect them to integrate that functionality of charts and showing data with Power BI?
There is an option to show a Power BI graphic into your Power Apps. So it's possible to show charts that you created in Power BI. You mm-hmm. can use it in your Power Apps application.
So that would eliminate the fact that it's not really nicely working. And I can see that it's not really working because it's very slow.
It's very slow, yeah.
Is it always that slow or?
The last time it wasn't.
Okay, this it's is just, the demo gods. The
demo gods, yeah.
Okay.
But it's also available the other way around. You can also take a Power App and use it in your Power BI report.
Okay.
So, but it's only available for Canvas applications.
Right.
Speaking of Canvas applications, I have also one of those I can show. This Canvas application is focused on a mobile. So it's for the mobile users. And within this application, I have created a little bit like an app for order pickers, where the order pickers see all the orders that are ready to send.
Mm-hmm.
And here they see the date, which item it is, and how many items. Mm-hmm. And they can go to the next page. And here they can edit the quantity and can send the order.
Okay. And that is very easy to create within the Power Apps.
Yeah, it's very easy. While the model-driven app really has the entities, and it's bound to the entities to change entities to create forms and views, within the Canvas application, you have more freedom, and you have more the low-code experience.
Mm-hmm. By the way, everything you do is in the browser, huh?
Yeah, everything is in the browser. Yes, that's correct.
So no, so like Power BI, we have Power BI desktop version, but there's no desktop version for this.
Not that I know of. Not that I know of.
Mm-hmm.
So here we have the editor for the Canvas applications, if it works. Yes. And here we have multiple things we can see. Here on the left side, we have the tree view with multiple screens, like the browse screen, that's the first screen. And here we have the edit screen.
Yeah.
That's the other screen. And within those screens, there are multiple elements like a button, an edit form, a label name and top side.
Mm-hmm.
And all these things are, you can change all those things. So for example, this edit form has a called sales orders. That's the sales orders I created for the model-driven app.
Okay.
And there are also here multiple columns, which multiple fields here you can change. You can really easily make it smaller or bigger. You can place the button somewhere else.
Yeah.
And also within the Canvas applications, you can upload some media to really create a really nice user interface.
Mm-hmm.
And there are also things like monitoring your applications and testing your applications. And there are also, and I can see it up here, multiple fields you can use. And also something like the AI builder within Power Platform and mixed reality.
Okay, this looks pretty, well, there's a lot of features in it if I compare it to the other one that you just shared.
Yeah, there are way more features in it, but the turn side is you have to do also a lot more. So you have to create the forms, you have to create the screens, you have to create the interaction within it.
But so, from what I see, creating a screen like this doesn't take that long, is it?
No, I think an app like this, you will take 1-2 hours, maybe 3.
Whoa. Well, that's pretty fast.
That's really fast, yeah.
And I don't need knowledge of how to create a mobile app.
No, that's correct. That's correct. Yeah. You just have to drag and drop those fields.
Yeah. Do you know if these apps are native apps? So like, does it run natively on Android and iOS, or is it a web app that's running in the browser?
I actually don't know.
That's a good question, huh?
Yeah, that's a good question. I know if you open these apps on your mobile, you have to install the Power Apps app.
Oh, that's right. It runs in a shell or something. Yeah.
And within the Power Apps app, you can open these apps. So maybe it's just a web application, a responsive web application. I don't know.
Yeah. Okay. Right.
So here I've shown the Canvas application. Let's go to the third one. That's the portal application. And the portal application is for external users.
Yeah, so, because to make it clear, the apps that you just saw, and including the Canvas app, that's only for internal use.
Yes. Those applications are only for internal use. So only for your core colleagues within the domain.
Yeah, okay.
And here right now we have a simple portal application. And this portal application is really a website and everyone can go there. So for example, here I have a simple basic website with my cycle that I sell and my book. And here people can check out the items I sell. Maybe I can add some text. I can add multiple pages, which are really slow to load, with more information about my products and what I sell.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also possible to interact with the common data servers here and insert some orders. So, for example, I can check my customer, Martijn Veenvliet. I can add an item like the book. And I say, I want five books. And here, after adding this.
You have to prove that you're a human. Yeah.
I have to prove I'm human. And I can submit my order. So in this way, the portal applications. Oh, it wasn't correct. I'm not human.
Okay.
This way, also external users can interact with your applications.
Okay. And how do you create these?
Yes, in the backside we have the portal editor, and I'm opening it here, and it's also a really low-code and drag-and-drop experience. Mm-hmm. Right now it's getting things ready. Yes, there it is. You have your web application and the web page. consists of multiple things. Now here we have all the pages we have, and here you can create some like a page hierarchy within your portal app. And each page consists of multiple components. So like you have a column section, and the column section are a kind of a row with multiple elements in with it. So for example, here on the top side, it's a column section of two columns. So you have column one here and column two.
Mm-hmm.
And within those columns, you can add some components like text, image, iframe, form, the list, breadcrumb, and of course, Power BI report.
Okay. This looks a bit limited.
Yes. Yes, it's very it's really limited because those are only the options you get.
Hmm.
It's possible to add some JavaScript to create more things. So
yeah, and of course by the option of being able to add iframes, so you can also include more complex web parts. But
yeah. That's it. So the portal apps for at this moment it's really basic. So these are like all the apps within the Power Apps. So there are three apps: the model-driven app focusing on the core processes and the core data. Mm-hmm. We have the Canvas application to focus more on the user experience and user interface.
Mm-hmm.
And as third, we have the portal application, which is for the external users.
Yeah.
So.
In the introduction, I already mentioned Mendix. Can you compare those two, like in functionality?
Sadly, I have no experience with Mendix and OutSystems, so I don't really know. But what I've heard is that OutSystems and Mendix are way further and more mature than Power Apps at this moment.
Yeah, it's not strange. They are specializing on low code platforms, where with Microsoft it's basically a side product. But what do you expect? Is there a lot of development power going on at Microsoft at the moment?
There's a lot. And if I compare it within the last half year, there are a lot of features extra, and they're constantly developing more features. And if I compare it with Power BI, Power BI was also a really niche tool like 2-3 years ago.
Yeah.
And if you see them right now, they're above in the right upper corner of the magic quadrant of Gartner.
Yeah. They were able to improve the functionality that Tableau offered.
Yeah.
Only within 2, maybe 3 years.
Yeah. So if you see that Power BI is increasing so fast and it's getting better so fast, it's also possible for Power Apps, I think.
Yeah.
So maybe in 1 year, maybe 2 years, Power Apps will be a big competitor for Mendix and OutSystems.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. You also had Power Automate in the Power Apps platform.
That's correct. Power Automate. Power Automate is very focused on automating workflows. So it's not really like creating an application. It's more making it easy to do multiple steps, or like send a mail when something happens.
And can you integrate that with the Power App?
Yes. I have a demo for that. If you wait a little, I will show it.
Cool.
There are 5 types of Power Automate flows. The first one is an automated flow, which is triggered by an event. For example, when a sales order is sent.
Mm-hmm.
You have the instant flow. That's one flow which happens after you trigger something. Maybe if you click a button, it happens.
Mm-hmm.
The scheduled flow, that's a flow which runs on a specific time. Maybe each day at 10 o'clock, for example.
Mm-hmm.
The UI flow is a flow which records user interface process and does the same thing again. So for example, can be used with legacy systems, which do not have an API to integrate with.
Okay, yeah.
And as last, you have the business process flow. And this is a flow to really help the end users during a complex process, which multiple steps have. For this session, I've created a flow that reacts on an event. And what I did is sending a mail after an order is shipped. So after one of my colleagues just hit the send button, my customer gets a mail with, "Hey, your order is sent." And if we go to the Power Apps IDE again, here we have the tab flows. Mm-hmm. And in this tab, there are all my flows I created. And for example, here, my sales order sent flow. And if we just click it open, this flow, we can see it's multiple steps, which are executed after each other.
So you have one IDE to create both the apps in the three different forms that we saw, model-driven, Canvas, and Portal apps. But also the Power Automate, the Power Flows can be created here as well.
Yes, that's all in one IDE. Yeah. And you also have here the chatbots and the AI builder, which you can also create in here.
Yeah.
So in here in the first row, here is when a record is created, updated, or deleted. That's an event. And mm-hmm. event is based on an update on the sales order table. So when the sales order table is updated, this event will go off and it will execute its flow.
So this is not hard coupled to the Canvas app that you just created, but no, it responds to a change in the data model.
Yes, correct. So what this does is first it checks, it has a condition, and it checks if the status is sent. So if your order is sent, and that sent is represented with this number. So this number means the order is sent.
It's a technical number, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So here we have two cases, if yes, so that means the order is sent, and we have the if no, and that means the order is not sent. Now, if the order is not sent, nothing happens.
Yeah, right.
But if the order is sent, we have here two lines for getting a record. And first, we're going to get a record of the customer of the sales order. And we do that so we can get his email address.
Yeah.
And the second one is getting the item, so we know which item the customer bought. And the third one is sending a mail. And here we have multiple dynamic fields, like the email, which I got from the customer, the number I got from the sales order.
Yeah.
And here we have added the item, the name of the item of the item.
Yeah.
And on this way, we have created the flow.
So and again, low code or no code, basically, because you're just querying things as it looks, but you don't use a SQL language for that or any other query language.
I haven't write any code for this.
No. This looks, by the way, almost identical to Logic Apps. Do you know whether there's a relation between the two?
I actually don't know Logic Apps, so.
Okay. I know Logic Apps, and this looks it looks almost identical to Logic Apps, so it will be built on top of it, I guess. But...
Okay. Here I am in a mailbox. I have one of those mails where the order is sent, and here we have the message. So your order is sent. And this order has those products. So that's Power Apps, Power Apps and Power Automate.
Well, okay. Well, that gave me a good impression of what a platform looks like. And well, it's good to hear that Microsoft is spending a lot of time and money on it to make it even better. It looks promising. When you dived into this, did you run into limitations where you thought, I want to do this, but you cannot do it, or?
Not really limitations, but what I walked into were mostly the lack of documentation. Because I've checked Microsoft Learn, I've checked YouTube, and it was not really easy to get the knowledge I wanted to get. But on the other side, the basic things to do were really easy, and I did not have to Google anything. I did not have to get more knowledge about it.
Yeah, but do you think that the user community of the Power Apps platform is small?
Yeah, it's small. Yeah. It's not so like it's not as big as Power BI or SQL Server, etc.
So Microsoft should do a bit about marketing on this this product. Yeah, okay. Definitely. Okay, well, thank you for this impression. I think it's really nice if you want to create a small application fast, and especially when you want to use it within your own organization, because it will definitely take a lot less time than when you have to build a mobile application, for example, and you have to first study Xamarin or other platforms on how to do that. And of course, if you need more and if you run into the limitations, to really program the application. But yeah, that's just the way it is. Okay, thanks, Martijn. I hope you liked this episode of the Data Discovery Channel and it gave you an impression of the Power Apps platform. If you did, just press the thumbs up icon below the video. And subscribe to the channel so that you always know when there's a new episode available. For now, thank you for watching and stay tuned to the Data Discovery Channel for the next episode. Goodbye.